As expected from my last review of Burn the Witch, things indeed started spicing up, and getting into some conclusions of sideline stories outside of Balgo's termination, which is great because it's relevant to the main end plot of the story. Chapter 3's colour page, however, was a single page spread with nothing to show for itself compared to its contemporaries. For example, the first one showed us some nice perceptions of landscape, showing us some awesome angles of Kubo's art, and displaying a certain aura with the characters' personalities just by a visual perception alone. The second colour page displayed our characters' personalities with their simple approach of eating food, giving the audience a look at their psychological depth. And with the colour page of chapter 3, it's just relaxing downtime. In the Japanese version, there is a red banner on the curtains saying "The Daily Life of Witches," while in the English version, this was removed. It's not a bad thing that the colour spread doesn't speak out to you as the audience, as prior spreads did previously. In fact, you could argue that it shows that beyond the supernatural elements, they are in fact just normal, relatable characters that you can in fact resonate with. So is that good in and of itself? It's completely up to the reader. As far as the chapter itself goes, it wastes no time in getting involved. We started off the chapter with Billy Banks getting an odd conversation with Sullivan. Yeah, I'm hesitant to discuss this conversation because while Sullivan does discuss the plan with Banks about the execution of Balgo, the interaction itself seemed to be letting off less than it actually was. The reactions from Banks felt unnatural and seemed like it was a one-sided disrespect than the discussion among ranks. Which personally tells me that Banks even knows something and is acting dumb or has no fear in the world and Nini's abilities as witches, that's really just my speculation with how these things usually go. Maybe Banks is just that much of a meme character and is that much brain dead. However, the way he is sneaking around to see if anyone was in the council room tells me kind of differently. But before I get into the parts that really fascinated and of course confused me, let's talk about Macy. While our last review was correct to assume that she was used as a pawn to execute the plan on capturing Balgo by creating a bit of a ruckus, it was definitely influenced in doing so by Bruno, as we expected. It seems the backstory here is that she did in fact have a latent ability to see a dragon, and apparently would eventually be joining the Reverse London later on down the road, to which I find interesting. If we think about all the different divisions of members in the Fawns, it's quite clear that they monitor the normal world, much as like how the Soul Society do in Bleach, such as like how it monitors and can communicate when there's a hollow or there's a high spike in spiritual pressure or Riatsu. Is it the same system in place here? That's the question. I unfortunately don't think we'll actually find out, but it's good information in terms of understanding how Noelle and Nini were in fact involved themselves within this line of work and how they were contacted. I was also pleasantly surprised that despite this only being a 4-chapter series, I generally believe that Macy would be a throwaway character, really to just be used to execute the plan. And Kubo really could have gotten away with it too. Though her character itself gives a backstory and character depth that allows for a third party explanations with not only how the world and its world building, but explanations towards the main characters too. So for a chapter that has less pages than the 4 that we're going to be getting, it was great to add context and development despite what would seem to be an expectation of a completely battle heavy chapter. So was this a battle heavy chapter? I would say half and half. It was more of a blue ball if I'm honest. Saving the grand finale to, well, you would have guessed, the last chapter. Which screams to me that Kubo will leave this on an open-ended story, which I think is ironically a great move, not only from a story standpoint, but also from a business standpoint as well. I was pleased to see that Nini and Noelle aren't pleased with the execution of Balgo and have no hesitation with taking on one of the high-ranked captains of this world and even showing some interesting feats to boot. While I love Nini and her attitude, as well as her being able to get close to the enemy in a seamless no-hesitation swiftness, that was really long to say, Noelle is most likely here to take the chapter. This, of course, doesn't take away from Nini, as she seems to be the one taking the damage, while Noelle seems to be the one taking the counters in this sense. Nini distracts Bruno a lot and holds him down, while Noelle takes the initiative and rescues Balgo and deals with the scrubs that were trying to capture him, as well as making a barrier within the time that Nini was dealing with Bruno and saving Macy. So this is no shade to Nini at all, but it would appear that Noelle came out unscathed in this situation, and seemingly the one that did the most within this chapter, but it kind of goes hand in hand. I'm glad that my questions had been answered, though in a still confusing way, showing what I've been constantly asking for, that if these tools were required to use what we would assume as magic. This is what I feel is important to me especially, as I can try and find out what I would try and categorize or conclude them to be within Bleach's world. Would they be Soul Reapers? Would they be Fallbringers or Quincy's? Going from the ability to see dragons, I would say they're either on the branch of either or, but that discussion can really be held for another day. I think the most compelling thing about this chapter in comparison to the other chapters is Kubo's paneling and direction in action scenes. This is where he excels and everything felt completely impactful, especially the dynamic of the double spread on towards the end of the chapter. Having this captain figure completely bust through Noelle's barrier like butter and showing the absolute speed he appeared in, with no sort of sense of danger to sudden appearance, makes me interested on how fast these characters actually are. What I'm interested in the most is what we will likely see in the next chapter is the abilities of Bruno and what he can really ultimately do. I would like to take a swing at it and say something like gravity, because there was like a gravity-esque kind of vibe to it, I felt, and I'm basing that on the damage from his surroundings, like from like building destruction, etc, etc, but I can really be pretty much off the mark with that, but it would be pretty epic. However, trying to understand what his powers are aside, his presence alone is very overwhelming and Kubo really cements that to the reader. My critiques, on which I'll keep light, as we may find out in the next week's chapter, which is the final one, I would like magic to be more understanding on what skills and abilities do. For example, Nini grabbing Macy showed magic when they came in contact with like touching her hand, for example. What did that do? What did that magic do? Did it make her lighter? Did it help with grip? What did that magic do? Like, we see it that it was implemented, it was there upon contact from Nini's side, but what did it do? Like, I don't really know. Maybe the anime will kind of demonstrate that a little bit better, but for now, it was kind of like, well, here you go, magic was there, it was used, good luck finding out what that did. But little examples like that are what I feel are important to the power system that is being ultimately utilized. And last but not least, Balgo has a bounty on his head that every wizard and witch are now aware of. So what is the point in Bruno capturing him and keeping him captivated for 72 hours? Is Bruno also going after the merit from the society that he lives in? Does he want that much praise and attention from Reverse London that he put a bounty on Balgo's head only for it to give a false perspective for the prize of the outsiders? You know what I mean? Like, he's like, hey, there's a bounty on Balgo's head, try and catch him. Ha, jokes on them, I've already got him and I'm gonna reap the reward for it too, even though I was the one that created the bounty. Or was he? Who knows? I don't know, but all I can say is that there's going to be a lot of pages next week, and I'm stupidly excited. Sad, but more so excited to see how this really all concludes and what future we can see for our Bleach sequel. If you want to class it as that or a spin-off, who knows? We'll see, and we'll discuss about that later on in the future. Are we going to get a Bleach character cameo? Will we see our absent character from the Horns appear? A lot of things to look forward to. But realistically, what are your guys' thoughts? Did I miss something? I most likely did. So if there's anything that you feel I should mention for next review, please smack it in the comment section. I would generally really appreciate it. I do enjoy talking about Burn the Witch, and I hope you guys are really enjoying the series too. Next week is the last chapter, so yeah, it's gonna be a mad one. So if you guys want to see the live reaction, it is exclusive to Patreon. There's a link in the description down below. If you want to join the Discord, there's a link to that too. Follow me on Twitter and all that good stuff. And I'll catch you guys next week. So yeah, you guys of course have this fine Devin Hansen. And as always, people, peace out.